sausages if you want, I don't mind. I'm not like the other girls, not like the other guys. Hold me close, cause it's too soon to say goodbye. You're some kind of beautiful, and you got me in the sky.
Okay, that's a little music from the TV show Emily in Paris, which my guest Robin Schiff is one of the executive producers on. My boss here, Jeremiah, loves that show, right?
Yes, and my friends. My friends love it.
Oh, yeah.
That's how I heard about it.
My daughter, I think I told you this. My daughter has Emily in Paris parties, and she's 35.
Oh, wow.
She has, literally, when this new season came on, she had a party and everybody had to come dressed Emily in Paris. So
she's gonna have to wait a while. I just found out yesterday that production has been moved to January, and that's even if we finish, we'd have to finish in probably middle of November with the strike. I don't know how long this strike is gonna last.
Yes, you are correct. I don't either. I've sort of always said Thanksgiving and people are like, that's crazy. It's like, no, it's not. That's not, you know, it's not crazy. So when I did see you in the strike line, you were talking about Emily in Paris and you were saying, and I've had jobs like this where these jobs come along. They're just fantastic jobs. They pay you well, but in this case, you get to go to Paris on this job. So tell us about that.
Here's, I might have said this to you that day, but many years ago, there was a shampoo commercial with Kelly LeBrock, and she would look at the camera and say, don't hate me because I'm beautiful.
Wow, that's like your character from St. Elmo's Breakfast Club.
That's, yeah, exactly. But that's how I feel when I tell other writers about Emily in Paris.
Yeah.
The writer's room starts in L.A., and we go for maybe 4 months, and then we move to Paris. And the writer's room continues in Paris. So we have a writer's room and during production, we're there and I'm there for 2.5 months. When the writer's room finishes, then I am done. One writer stays there for 4.5 months, but he's like friends with the cast. And
right.
As much as I love living in Paris, and I love it, it's so much fun. It's such a great city. I'm ready to come home after 2.5 months, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I miss
my friends and my mom's 91. And
what's her name again? Estelle?
Sorrell.
Yes. What a character she was.
Yeah.
My wife had a store, if you remember, on Montana, and you would come in there occasionally. So this job, and you said that day, it's like one of the greatest jobs I've ever had, and the strike, you know, interrupted it, which is the price of this, one of the prices of this strike. But I was thinking that's such a great, was there a job? Well, you sort of said it, like what drove you to the union? You got fired off a job. Was there one job in particular that like stands out in your mind? Like, I can't believe this happened. Like, this is a tragedy that this happened because this show or movie or whatever went away.
Oh, you mean something I was sad about?
Yeah. Something you were sad or mad or about.
Oh, I know exactly what it was. It was Almost Perfect. It was a show I created with Ken Levine and David Isaac starring Nancy Travis. It was on in the late 90s. It was such a good show. I'm so out of it. I showed the pilot to a big like lecture class at USC, and I had girls coming up to me afterwards because the main character was a successful TV writer producer who also was in a relationship and wanted both. And I had girls come up and say it, they can never see successful women like that in comedies. You know, you see them more in dramas.
Right.
But that show should have stayed on the air and it got canceled and broke my heart. I was just shocked.
Yeah, it's just, and it really does. People, you try to explain like your heart can get broken, you know, with the show doesn't happen or, you know, I didn't get Saturday Night Live and I went to bed for about 5 months, you know, just like, you know, just like, what am I, what? I, you know, it's a heartbreaking moment. And you try to explain it to people, it's like, no, it's a TV show. But it's the life of the performer or the writer that literally puts their life into this stuff. And
changed my whole life if that show had continued. I've managed to work 42 years, and the first hit show I worked on is Emily in Paris. I've done nothing but new shows. They always get canceled. So I have no residuals.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah,
I've been lucky enough because of Greg Garcia to be on shows that have gone into syndication, and it's great. I mean, you know, they get less and less, but it's really great. That's interesting. I'm sure the movies you've written, but again, how many movies did you write that never got made, or somebody else came in and got credit? Or
after Romy and Michele, trying to think if I wrote any other movies. I probably wrote some movies, but nothing that got made. But I'm more of a TV watcher than a movie person, and more, I consider myself a TV writer, even though the thing I'm known for the most is a movie.
Right.
I've done most of my work in TV.
But it is interesting that one movie, that movie can, you know, we've talked so much about it today and people want to hear about it. It really has been an incredible calling card. And I love the fact that it started at the Groundlings. It started as a sketch.
Well, it's really having a moment right now. It had its 25 year anniversary of coming out last year. And there was a big article in Vogue.com, like a huge, long, you know, he wanted to do like a comprehensive oral history. If anyone's interested, it's really good. And you can find it online. But we just had one of those Cinespia Hollywood Forever Cemetery screenings, sold out 3 weeks before the screening, 4,000 people there. American Cinematheque is doing another screening, sold out in a week. And young people, I went to
Hollywood Forever Cemetery.
And it's like, how are they finding the movie? And I watched the movie, this was 3 weeks ago, and I don't know how I escaped not writing something I could be canceled for. You know, how did I manage that? Yeah. I don't know how. There's one line in the movie that I was kind of cringing about where Romy, there, it's at the beginning of the movie, and Romy says, sometimes I wish I was a lesbian. And Michele says, want to try and have sex sometime just to see if we are? And Romy's like, yuck, Michele, just the thought of having sex with another woman creeps me out. I'm going, oh, fuck.
Whoops, there's another one.
So sorry. I'm so sorry.
No worries.
But then I finished, followed it up with, but if we're not married by the time we're 30, ask me again. So, okay, good. I got out of that one. But yeah, it's amazing to me. And I stood at that Hollywood Forever Cemetery just feeling kind of overwhelmed.
Yeah. I do remember. I mean, it's just, again, the Groundlings thing. I, you know, as I get older, I look back at that experience. You know, you mentioned Paul Rubens, who just passed away, and he was so, just so successful, what he took there and built an entire empire of Pee-wee. But I look back at that first night, and everybody has that experience. You go to the Groundlings the first time and you're just sort of blown away. You went to the box office and asked how to take a class.
Yeah.
Went that night and didn't know anything. I happened to go to a party afterwards, literally that night, and Phil Hartman was at the party.
Oh,
that's
wow.
How I found it. And I just saw him. I said, oh my God, I just saw this show. That's how I found out. Well, there were class. I said, how do you do that? Well, they're, yeah, that voice, that class is there. And he had a little, when people carry little address books, he had Maxwell's number.
Wow.
And yeah, call this guy.
Already acting?
I'm sorry?
You already acting?
No, I had literally, I was a bartender at the Troubadour. And I read about the Groundlings in the LA Weekly. And I went and bought a ticket. But when you had to go to the theater to buy a ticket. There was no computer, anything like that. And I bought a ticket. And I've told this story before in the show where I only knew one person when I moved to LA who was a cocaine dealer. But I didn't do cocaine. It was never my thing. And so he said, come to this party afterwards. So I go to the Groundlings, and it's Paul and it's Phil and it's John Paragon, who I always think within the space of that building is the funniest Groundling. I just thought Paragon got the
Paragon was amazing.
The hardest laughs, just like, how does he do that? But I go to the party and Hartman's there, and that's how I found the Groundlings was. Wow. So
I remember Hartman doing Light Man. Do you remember?
Yes, of course. Well, I was a stage manager, and I used to have to help him with the flashlights.
And then he did this like sniper.
Yes.
Like a crazy military. I don't know how he made that funny, but
I'm not sure it was funny. I think it was funny because he was doing
Paul Rubens doing a panel with that guy, Little, who was like Moses Feldman.
His character, Little Yehudi.
Little Yehudi.
Here's one to get canceled. Paul doing a Native American lounge singer, Chief J. Longtoe. And his song was, "Soon It's Gonna Rain. I Can Feel It." So he's doing a rain chant. As part of a lounge song, it's just crazy stuff. Sadly, I'm getting the motion from Dr. D. We're out of time.
It's fine. You're good at this. You know, you should keep doing this, Tim.
Yes. I have nothing else to do. So, yes. And Jeremiah keeps funding these things. So I'm not sure why he does that, but he does it. So thank you to Jeremiah again. Dr. D., our engineer. Robin Schiff, thank you so much for doing it. Really fun. I'll see you in line sometime. Yeah.
We'll look forward to that.
Okay. See you. Thanks again, Robin. We'll see you soon.
Bye.
And you've been listening to It's Radio with TV's Tim Stack. We'll see you next time.